Hello and welcome back everyone, this is Sancarn again here bringing you another video, and in this video we are going to further explore some of the properties of the Farlands. When I was doing some experimentation in the Farlands, I found this weird flickering sand block. I was wondering, why is this happening? So I decided to find out the core properties of sand blocks, and from that, make my own hypothesis as to why this is happening. Then we can find out exactly how we can use this little quirk to our own advantage. So, how does a sand block fall? When a sand block is updated, the game checks whether there is an air block beneath it. If an air block is found, the game will first obtain the position of the sand block. Then, the game will summon a falling sand entity into said position. Now, if the falling sand entity is inside a sand block, the game will delete the block. Otherwise, the game will delete the falling sand entity. If a falling sand entity is successfully summoned, it will start to fall. When the entity hits the ground, the sand entity is deleted, and the block is placed at the coordinates of the arithmetic floor of the entity's position. Now we're going to look at very large floating point numbers. When floating point numbers get very large in programming languages, they start to become less and less accurate. This is because of an arithmetic limitation of the computers called integer overflow. An integer overflow occurs when an arithmetic operation attempts to create a numeric value that is too large to be represented within the available storage space. This can easily be explained with a mechanical number counter. As we add 1 each time, the counter counts up by 1. When we reach the number 9 and add 1, we see the number on the far right-hand side of the counter go to 0. And the next number along goes to 1. When the second cell goes to 9, and the first cell is also at 9, and we add 1, the number 1 ripples across, turning the 9s in the first and second cells to 0, and then finally turning the third cell into a 1. Now, let's say we have 9s in every single cell of our counter. Now we add 1. Now the carry goes through, turning all the 9s to 0. And that it does. But now we have this extra carry of 1. However, this cannot be displayed on our counter. So in total, we have lost a 1. Of course, with a complex mathematical program, we do not wish this to happen. Instead, programming languages such as Java come up with their own ways of dealing with these overflows. However, these algorithms can result in inaccuracies. These inaccuracies may seem small at first, like turning 10,000 into 9,999.99999. However, with many complex arithmetic operations and many inaccuracies, these can lead to extreme errors. For example, let's do 10 to the power of 33. In maths, we know this is a decillion. However, if 10 had a minor change to, let's say, 9.99, we would have 9.99 to the power of 33. This is 9.675 times 10 to the 32. i.e., we have an error of about 3.25 times 10 to the 31. This is a massive error. So, what does this have to do with Minecraft, you might ask? The point is, when we are in the Farlands, we are dealing with these large numbers. A lot of arithmetic operations occur when translating integers to floats. When a sand block falls, it takes the integer position of the block and translates that into the position for the falling sand entity. The position for the falling sand entity, like other entities, is a floating point number. so it takes the integer position of the sand block and translates that into the floating point position of the falling sand entity. So when the falling sand entity is summoned by the game, it is in a completely different position to the sand block itself. This is due to the errors we have just talked about. This explains why some sand blocks don't fall in the Farlands. When we place a block of sand, the block instantaneously updates. The game sees there is an air block beneath the sand, so the game finds the position of the sand. Then, the game converts the integer position of the sand to a floating point representation of the position. This is a little inaccurate and summons the falling sand entity outside the block itself. The game checks whether the falling sand entity is inside a sand block. After realizing that it isn't inside a sand block at all, it deletes the falling sand entity, and the sand block is left floating in the air. So let's go back to this flickering sand block glitch. How does this work? Well, it's actually quite simple. When we place the sand block on the right, it updates the sand block on the left. The game sees there is an air block beneath the sand, so the game finds the position of the sand. It then converts the integer position of the sand to a floating point representation of the position. This is a little inaccurate, and summons the falling sand entity inside the block on the right. The game then checks whether the falling sand entity is inside a block. The game finds that it is and deletes the sand block it is inside, leaving the falling sand entity behind. This falling sand entity falls and hits the ground in the next game tick. When it hits the ground, the falling sand entity is deleted and replaced with a sand block. This re-updates the sand block on the left, repeating the process. So the final thing is, what can we use this wonderful glitch for? Well, there are many metadata changes around at the moment, aren't there? So I figured, you know, I'd make my own metadata changer. So now we have a cheaper metadata changer right here. Now, of course, this only works with falling sand entities, so it only works with anvils. So you can turn broken anvils into non-broken anvils, and we can also turn like red sand into normal sand or normal sand into red sand, which is also pretty cool. But apart from that, we can't actually do a whole lot with this metadata changer. Ever wanted a strobe light? Pop a redstone torch behind this sand block and it'll produce a strobe. When the sand is a block, it blocks the light completely, but when it is an entity, light passes straight through it. This causes a strobe effect. The final thing that I found that we could do with this is we can keep the sand in your sand cannon in a falling state for you to prepare to launch it. But I'm afraid, guys, that's all I have time for this video. So I guess I'll see you again in the next video.